In the 1930s, Louis Leakey and his archaeologist wife, Mary Leakey, discovered crude stone tools in the Olduvai Gorge in Tanzania, which later became known as the Olduwan Stone Industry. This archaeological couple, along with their team, worked at the site for several decades, searching for the creators of these primitive tools. A major breakthrough for the Leakey family came in 1960, when they unearthed the jawbone of a hominin from the deeper layers of sediment in the Olduvai Gorge. This discovery was followed over the next 3 years by additional finds, including more fragments of this hominin, along with primitive stone tools. Among the finds was a fragmented skull, which ultimately provided a picture of a hominin who, due to its tool-making abilities, was given the name Homo Habilis, or handyman, earning the title of the first stone tool maker. However, as mentioned in the previous video, it was later determined that Australopithecus species also had the ability to create such tools, and Homo habilis was not the first hominin tool maker. The fossils of Homo habilis discovered in the Olduvai Gorge are approximately 1.8 million years old. Most of the Homo habilis fossils have been reported from the Olduvai Gorge in Tanzania and from the eastern side of Lake Turkana in Kenya. Interestingly, the fame of Homo habilis is often associated with the discovery of a skull near the eastern side of Lake Turkana in the mid-1970s. However, this particular specimen, following extensive research by scientists, was eventually classified as a distinct species and given the name Homo rudolfensis. Researchers concluded that these two hominins, Homo habilis and Homo rudolfensis, should be categorized as separate species, despite having lived during the same time period. Other Homo habilis fossil specimens have been discovered at sites north and south of Olduvai Gorge, Lake Turkana, the Uraha site in Malawi, and Sterkfontein in South Africa. The cranial capacity of Homo habilis ranges between 600 and 700 cubic centimeters. The relatively small size of their teeth compared to body size suggests a connection between tool use, diet quality, and intelligence. In contrast, the brain size of Homo rudolfensis is about 750 cubic centimeters, on average slightly larger than Homo habilis. However, due to the more pronounced and robust facial bone structure in Homo rudolfensis, compared to the more delicate facial features of Homo habilis, scientists have proposed the hypothesis that the genus Homo diverged from Homo habilis, while Homo rudolfensis became extinct on its evolutionary path. The hominins who lived around 2.5 million years ago had become highly skilled in direct percussion flaking. The large number of well-crafted flakes and the relatively few flawed flakes resulting from missed strikes are evidence of this skill. The hand of Homo habilis is anatomically similar to that of modern humans. Additionally, bone and wooden tools were often either flaked in a similar manner as stone tools or used without any modification. The Broca's area in the brain is responsible for controlling facial and tongue movements and is located near and connected to the nerves that control hand movement. Studies conducted on the endocast of the Homo habilis skull show evidence of the formation of Broca's area in the left hemisphere of its brain. These findings suggest that in humans and their ancestors, common tool-making activities involved a division of labor between the hands, holding objects steady with one hand and using tools with the other. This preference for hand specialization likely led to hemispheric lateralization in the brain. Such lateralization and stimulation of Broca's area may have laid the foundation for the evolution of language. It's noteworthy that, unlike humans, chimpanzees show no clear lateralization in hand use. The ability to strike a stone and create flakes may seem relatively simple to a modern human, but for early hominins, it was a significant advancement. It is impossible to imagine what was going through the mind of the first hominin who deliberately began crafting stone tools with a vision of the end result. Although we can infer from the tools they made that they had a concept in mind, their thinking must have been vastly different from our own. What can be said with certainty is that this innovation paved the way for new abilities to emerge. The set of skills and capacities that subsequently developed in the human lineage far surpassed anything seen in modern apes. There is no doubt that the first tool-making hominins had made tremendous strides in visualization and imagination compared to their ancestors. These early tool-makers not only understood how to manipulate stone, but also knew what specific tools they needed to create, demonstrating cognitive abilities and planning that set them apart from earlier species. Hominins, much like us, engaged in advanced planning. This claim is supported by archaeological evidence showing that before making tools, they transported raw, unworked stones over distances of around 3 kilometers and sometimes up to 10 kilometers to another location where they would then craft their desired tools. High-quality stones suitable for tool-making and flaking were not found just anywhere. They were only available in specific locations, which may have been far from the places where the tools were actually made and used. In some archaeological sites where butchered animal bones have been discovered, archaeologists have also found stone tools made from raw materials, stones not native to the surrounding area. The only logical explanation for the presence of these stones is that hominins brought them to the location themselves. Homo habilis, like Australopithecus, were omnivorous creatures and generally relied on scavenging for protein. Due to their vulnerability in nature, similar to other primates and their ancestors, they lived in small groups of a few individuals. Some researchers propose the hypothesis that Homo habilis, which lived from approximately 2.5 million years ago to around 1.65 million years ago, should also be considered a species of Australopithecus.